How would you feel in a world where half of doctors, lawyers, and counselors would be machines? How would you feel in a world where half of caretakers of your elderly people or young children would be robots? How would you feel in a world where her would be a computer? Those questions are not mine. They surround us. They fascinate us. And sometimes they scare us. Because those are questions about ourselves. Those are questions about how different we are and how different we feel from the machines that we build. Those are questions about a race between artificial intelligence and human intelligence. As a control scientist, I'm studying the control mechanism that enable intelligence, both in the machine and in nature. And today, I would like to share with you a control mechanism that is different in the brain and in the computer. This difference is so simple that it's almost embarrassing to talk about it. And yet, I think it tells us a great deal about how differently we compute from the machines that we build. But let's start from the beginning. The race between the computer and the brain started in 1950 in Cambridge, when Alan Turing, one of the greatest scientists of last century, invented a game, the Imitation Game. A modern version of the game is as follows. You receive an invitation on Facebook, but you don't know whether your new friend is a machine or a human. So you engage a conversation with her, trying to figure out whether her has a brain. And if you do figure out, you win. If you don't, you lose. Turing predicted that by the year 2000, machines would win the Imitation Game most of the time. Turing's paper set a fundamental link between intelligence and computation. And the Imitation Game launched one of the richest dialogues of contemporary science. For the last 60 years, the brain has been a model of the computer, and the computer has been a model of the brain. And here we are, 60 years later. Our pocket machines solve our daily calculations, correct our spelling mistakes, complete our sentences, translate our texts, solve our quiz, teach us how to play chess. Machines solve those complicated computations by decomposing them into a sequence of very simple operations. So they need memory to store the intermediate steps, and they need processors to execute the operations. And computer technology has developed steadily to a point where those pocket machines can store huge memories and execute operations at a speed that literally approaches the speed of light. And this makes computers incredibly fast at solving computations that would be formidable for our brains. So the victory of computer technology is really humbling for the brain. To the point where you wonder whether there is still anything our brains can do better than computers when it comes to computing. Well, I think there is at least one thing our brains still do much better than computers. We forget what we memorize, we disregard what we see, and often we don't listen what we hear. That might have been a problem at school. And perhaps you consider this as a further weakness of your brain compared to the computer, because computers do not forget what they memorize. Machines do not disregard what they see. But forgetting and disregarding is the basis of discerning. Our brains keep discerning. Machines are quite bad at discerning. And this makes our brain fast, in fact, much faster than computers, at zooming in and zooming out on the relevant information. A few weeks ago, I was hiking with my wife in the part of Turkey called Lycia, in the Mediterranean Sea. And on an afternoon, we decided to go down 500 meters below our hiking path to explore a beautiful little beach. It was already 2 p.m., so we are a bit in a hurry. And as we were running down this very rocky terrain and looking for these small yellow and red signs that would lead us to the beach, I kept thinking how challenging it would be for a machine to do what was great fun for us. Because we are quite good at detecting those small signs just because they matter to us. But then relaxing on the beach and recovering from the descent, I remember all these awareness experiments designed by neuroscientists. I remember missing a gorilla in a team of basket players just because my mind was focusing on the ball passes. This is amazing. I think it will take a lot of time before computers can miss a gorilla among a team of basket players. So this ability of detecting very small things or ignoring very big things, depending on our state of mind. This ability of focalizing our computations in a very specific window in time and space, and then modulating this window very quickly. I would call this plastic localization or multi-resolution. Brains are super fast at executing, but they are rather slow at localizing because they are rigid, they are mono-resolution. Brains, instead, are rather slow at executing, but they are incredibly fast at localizing and at modulating the resolution. They are plastic. They are multi-resolution. But why is that? Why can't we make machines plastically localize? To me, localization has not much to do with how fast you compute or how big you can store. It has to do with a control mechanism, which brings me to the second part of my talk. 2 years before Turing's paper, Norbert Wiener, a respected control engineer at MIT, published a book where he mostly emphasized the fundamental role of feedback to intelligence. A feedback processor is a processor that feeds the output back at the input. So this processor does not process the input signal you intend to process. Instead, it processes a comparison between that intended signal and the signal that is actually seen at the output. And you are all very familiar with feedback, because we all know how important it is to learning. How could we learn without errors? How could we form errors without comparing intended action and actual actions? But there are two types of feedback, negative feedback and positive feedback. Negative feedback is how your thermostat works. The input to your heating system is not the desired temperature. It is a comparison between the desired temperature and the actual temperature. And the processor tries to make the input and output alike, so it is a regulating device. And we are surrounded by negative feedback. Negative feedback is what regulates the temperature in this room, the temperature of your body, the speed of your car, and the speed of your heart. Positive feedback is the opposite of negative feedback. Here you add the output to the input. So if there is a change at the input, you further amplify that change. And as a result of this instability, you get an all or none device. You get a switching device. Positive feedback is everywhere around us. Positive feedback switches on, off and on the light in your living room, but also the genes in your cells and the transistors in your computer. So plenty of negative feedback, plenty of positive feedback. Now let's imagine a device that would have the two feedback loops, one for positive, the other one for negative, a mix of switching and regulation. If you ever raise a child or a pet, you might think that this is not so bad as a policy. Positive feedback is a switch between reward and punishment, something stimulating, but you like to balance this with a regulation of emotions, which is negative feedback. So it seems that intelligence promotes the mixed feedback policy. But an engineer would probably tell you that this device is not optimal. because every feedback loop has a cost. So you might convince an engineer that you need one feedback loop, either for regulating or for switching, but you will have a hard time convincing an engineer that you need a second feedback loop to undo what the first feedback loop is doing. And this is one of many reasons why you will not find that device in technology. It has not survived the technological evolution. And that was my control education. Plenty of positive feedback, plenty of negative feedback, never a mix. And that picture changed when I started studying feedback mechanisms in nature. First as a hobby, more than as a profession. I wasn't surprised to find lots of positive feedback and negative feedback in nature, but I was increasingly surprised to see that every single device in nature seems to have the two feedback loops. Hardwired, at twice the cost of a single feedback loop. So either natural evolution obeys different rules than technological evolution, or engineers have missed something here. So here comes that different mechanism. Plenty of negative feedback, plenty of positive feedback, everywhere. Always separated in technology, never separated in nature. This difference is so simple that it's almost embarrassing to talk about it. But today my research is entirely about exploring that difference. Because I believe that the mixed feedback principle is the essence of plastic localization, of multi-resolution, this property that our brains do not share with machines. The mixed feedback processor is plastic. This is a long story, but here is a cartoon. On the right, you have a strong positive feedback. So the output is all or none, a switching device. On the left, you have a lazy regulator. Input is the same as the output, a regulating device. But in the center, you have this balanced processor. And the balanced processor can be turned into a switching or regulating device by a mere modulation of the balance between the positive and negative feedback. This processor is highly localized. It activates in a very narrow range. But this localization is not just in range, it is also in time. Because if you make the positive feedback a bit faster than the negative feedback, your device will first switch, then regulate. And this is called an excitable behavior. And this behavior is the behavior of every single of your neurons. And you can also localize in space, because you can make the positive feedback short range and the negative feedback longer range. And by localizing in time and space, you will build a wave with a certain wavelength in space and time. And once you build one wave, you can start modulating the frequency, the spatial and temporal frequency of that wave, by relying on the collective activity of many, many such balanced processors. And nature has found an incredible amount of different ways to modulate the resolution. But always, it seems that there is this very simple feedback principle at work. Never a positive feedback without the negative counterpart. I wish to think, at the core of the computer, we have transistors. And transistors are switches. This is a positive feedback technology. At the core of the brain, we have neurons that emit action potentials, which is produced by the combination of a positive and negative feedback, a mixed feedback technology. And your 10 billion of neurons collaborate in many, many different ways to change the wavelength of those localized signals. I wish to think that machines will not win the next stage of the imitation game until they will have incorporated the mixed feedback principle at their core. So whether you enjoy scientific predictions or whether you are scared by scientific predictions, you should acknowledge that the imitation game and artificial intelligence has changed our world, indeed. But that the machine has not eradicated the human yet. Instead, perhaps artificial intelligence has improved our understanding of ourselves, because it has improved our understanding of how different we are from machines. And this is perhaps something of interest to all of us, because we all like to play the imitation game. We all like to assess how much her is different from a machine. So next time you play the imitation game, you may want to remember that your best advantage is perhaps not fast computing or quiz solving. Your best advantage is perhaps your ability to balance your positive and negative feedback at many different scales. Your best advantage is perhaps to discerning, at least for a while. Thank you very much.